All right, guys, welcome to week one of bio, week five of AP Psych. After last week's tremendous success, I'm looking forward to continuing us right into our next chapter, our next section. Now, we're starting biology, which means we're going to start with the very basic elements of biology, the neurons in our body. They're all over our body. Their highest density of them are in our brain. So obviously, we're going to start with the how neurons work, the different types of chemicals they use. And then next week, we're going to start the brain. Then we're going to get a little more complicated moving past beyond that. So this is the first week. Like I said in class, this is the foundation of all of biology. If you do not really learn this content this week, then next week you're going to be really, really struggling. So everything kind of builds on each other for biology. So let's get started. Now, what we're going to really be focusing is, how does our body communicate internally? How do we know what different parts of our body are doing at different types of places, doing different types of things? Well, the major way our body is constantly communicating with ourselves is through the nervous system and the endocrine system. Both use chemical messengers to communicate with targets throughout the body. Everything in our body is in constant communication. And how we know how to take a step or how to reach and what our body wants to do is all through these two systems, the endocrine and the central communication or the central nervous system, do this by using neurons, the basic foundation of our body. So what is a neuron? Well, we have different types of neurons. We have a sensory neuron, which carries information from the sense receptors, so from your fingers, from your legs, from your feet, from your toes, all the way towards the central nervous system, to your spine, to your brain. And all of these, when we're taking messages from our sensory receptors, our toes, our hands, our skin, when they're going to our brain, they're called afferent nerves or sensory neurons. When our brain sends a message back to our different parts of our body, it's called a motor neuron. It carries messages from the central nervous system towards muscles and glands. These are known as efferent nerves. Okay, so when we're sending messages from our brain to our muscles to move, those are using efferent nerves. When we're receiving a message from our hand saying that there's a fly on our hand, those are efferent nerves. When our brain sends the response to smack at it, those are using efferent nerves. We also have interneurons, which carry messages between nerve cells. These are how all of that information gets sent. Interneurons is more common than sensory neurons or motor neurons. So what is a neuron? Let's talk about the structure of them. Now, the major structure of the neuron is called the soma, or the cell body of the neuron. It holds the nucleus and the cytoplasm. This is where all the decisions take place. The soma is connected to the axon, which is the transmission cord. It's the communication cord, which connects the soma to the other neurons. So the axon continues all the way through until it gets to the terminal buttons. Once we're at the terminal buttons, it's at the very end of a neuron. Now, these terminal buttons are the exit places where these chemical messages are coming out of. Now, these terminal buttons connect to another neuron's dendrites, or the receiving end of a cell's information, and in between these two places where the terminal buttons and the dendrites connect is called the synapse. And this is where the messages are being transmitted from one nucleus to the next. Now, we're going to spend a lot of time in class working through this and really discussing this content to give you a better idea, but this is just a way for you to be familiar. Now, we keep talking about how electrical energies are being sent from one thing to the next, but what does that really mean? What it means is all of our messages are being sent through neural impulses. These neurons are sending electrical charges through them. So what is a neural impulse? It's a brief electric surge that carries the neuron's message from one neuron to the next. Ions, which are charged particles that are moved across the cell membrane, are located inside of every neuron. In every neuron, the cell body, the neuron's body, is negatively charged. Once the neural impulse comes through, it creates a positive charge, which creates the change. Now, how does all of this come together? Okay, now the resting potential, when a neuron is not receiving a message, it is negatively charged when it's not stimulated. So when nothing is going on, there's no messages that the neuron's receiving, it's negative. When it has action potential, which means it's being fired through, it means the neuron is changing from a negative to a positive charge. Now, when it's stimulated, the membrane opens up, allowing positive sodium to rush in, and the action potential is the shift in a neuron's electrical charge that travels along the axon. Okay, so when it's all by itself, it's negative. Once it receives a message, that neural impulse or that message turns everything positive, and that's how we get the message through. Resting potential negative, action potential positive. Like I said, we're going to be going through this in much greater detail in class. So what are neurotransmitters? Neurotransmitters are chemical messengers that relay neural messages across the synapse. Now, when we're exchanging information from one membrane to another membrane or another cell, we're using neurotransmitters. And there's different types of neurotransmitters for different situations. We're going to talk about those right now in a minute. Now, what does it all mean when we have action potential, resting potential, neurotransmitters, synapse, dendrites, all those things? What it means is that our body is so well wired that the connections between it is what makes us work, what makes us function, which allows us to think, which allows us to move. A firing of one single neuron is not enough to create a twitch in an eyelid in sleep, let alone a conscious impression. What I want you to understand in this scope, in this example, is that in order for us to even blink our eyes or even think of what it means to be happy, it takes hundreds of millions. I mean, that's not even a huge... even close example of what it takes, hundreds of billions of neurons to actually make that one thought process. Okay, millions of neurons must fire in unison to produce the most trifling thought. Okay, neurons are the basis of our entire thinking process, our entire body structure. That's why they're important. If you don't understand neurons, you don't understand anything else. Neurotransmitters are fundamental to behavior, muscle movements, to moods, and mental health. I mean, they're the whole bag of chips here. If neurons are the foundation of absolutely everything in our body, without neurons, there would be nothing going on. We wouldn't even be here, essentially. So there's seven important neurotransmitters that we're going to really be talking about. Now, some of them we've gone into in class, especially last week we were talking about drugs, and some are going to be a little bit more familiar. Some of them are going to be very unfamiliar. But we're going to go through this together and really discuss what each one does on their own. Now, dopamine, it produces sensations of pleasure, reward, used by the central nervous system, neurons, and voluntary movements, okay? Now, I've already used this acronym without fully introducing it. When we see CNS, it's central nervous system. That's our brain, that's our spinal cord, okay? So, dopamine is the pleasure and reward, and it's used in voluntary movements. Problems when we don't have enough dopamine, okay, with imbalance, okay, is we have schizophrenia and Parkinson's disease. Substance that affect it, okay, or mimic it is cocaine, amphetamines, Ritalin, and alcohol, okay? So dopamine is pleasure and reward. If we have too much or too little of it, we have schizophrenia and Parkinson's disease. Serotonin, it helps us to regulate sleep and dreaming, mood, pain, aggression, appetite, and sexual behavior. problems with imbalance. If you don't have enough serotonin, you have depression, certain anxiety disorders, obsessive compulsive disorder. Now, please keep in mind, it's either too much or too little, and we're going to start talking about a little more in class about the specifics. If too much, you have anxiety, too little, you have depression. Substances that affect it is Prozac, hallucinogens, LSD, pull very, very closely on serotonin. Now, norepinephrine controls heart rate, sleep, sexual responsiveness, stress, vigilance, and appetite. And when we have too much or too little of it, it can cause high blood pressure or depression. Some substances that affect it is trichelytic antidepressants and beta blockers. Acetylcholine is a primary transmitter used by neurons carrying messages from the central nervous system, is involved in kinds of learning and memory. So it's from the central nervous system, so it would be an efferent neuron. Remember, it's a motor neuron. It's coming out from the central nervous system. It's used in certain muscular disorders and Alzheimer's disease. Remember, when we're dealing with muscular disorders, it means that our muscles aren't moving on command. If the motor neurons are not entering your muscles correctly and are telling them what to do, that's when we have that problem. Substances that affect it are nicotine, curare, and atropine. Now, GABA is the most prevalent inhibitory neurotransmitter of the central nervous system. All right, what it does if you have too much is you have anxiety or epilepsy. Barbiturates, tranquilizers, Valium, alcohol, all affect it. So what happens is GABA is the one relating all the information into your mind, into your body, into your central nervous system. Glutamine is a primary excitatory neurotransmitter in the central nervous system. It's involved with learning and memory. Brain damage, if we have too much or too little, brain damage after a stroke. Angel dust is what gets this going. Now, GABA slows us down. Glutamine gets us excited. Okay, so GABA keeps us regulated. Glutamine helps get us moving a little bit faster. Endorphins are pleasurable sensations and control of pain. Problems with the imbalance, lowered levels resulting from opiate addiction. Opiates, opium, heroin, morphine, and methadone are very similar to it. Okay, so we just talked about all the transmitters that we have in our body and their basic purposes. Let's talk about the glial cells. Glial cells provide structural support of neurons. They're the ones allowing to ensure it's successful. It helps in forming new synapses, making sure all of our neurons are connected. They help form myelin sheath. Okay. If you want to go back to Mouse Party, you're more than welcome to. You can click on that and go visit. We went through that pretty heavily last week, but it kind of explains a little bit more about it. Now, the organization of the nervous systems are put into two major categories, which break down into subcategories. Remember, our neurons are part of our nervous system, okay? Now, our nervous system is broken down into two major categories, the peripheral and the central. Under the peripheral, we have the autonomic and the somatic, okay? Under the autonomic, we have the sympathetic and the parasympathetic. We're going to go into much greater detail, don't you worry. Okay, so the organization of the nervous system, this diagram gives you a great synopsis of kind of what's going on with different nerves. Don't worry, you won't have to know all of them. You will have a pretty good understanding of most of them by the end of this. Now, the peripheral nervous system is made up of all the nerves that lie outside the brain and the spinal cord. Peripheral, outside, peripheral, perimeter, outside the brain and the spinal cord. Nerves of bundles or of neuron fibers, axons that are routed together in peripheral nervous system. So what it is a cluster of neurons together which form a little, you know, city of neurons that are very, very highly sensitive, okay? Very much so, overwhelmingly sensitive, okay? So the peripheral nervous system is everything outside the brain and the spinal cord. Now the somatic nervous system is made up of nerves that connect to voluntarily skeletal muscles and sensory receptors. Now the somatic nervous system are connected to muscles, okay? These are nerves that are the cables that carry information from the receptors in the skin to the muscles and joints. Muscles and skin, okay, from the sensory receptors in our skin to muscles in our joints. There's the connection between the two. Autonomic nervous system is made up of nerves that connect to the heart, blood vessels, smooth muscles, and glands, controls all involuntary functions that people don't think about. Okay? So anything that you naturally do is controlled by the autonomic nervous system. Okay? So all of the stuff that our body is regularly doing, our heart beating, our kidneys, our breathing, our digestion, all of those things that we don't have to make a conscious thought about is all done by the autonomic nervous system. Now, the central nervous system is the one that's in charge of it all. Central nervous system can consist of the brain and the spinal cord. The spinal cord connects the brain to the rest of the body through the peripheral nervous system. The brain is the crown and glory of the entire central nervous system, okay? So the central nervous system is your brain and your spine. Now, how the spine and your brain gets all their information is from the peripheral nervous system. Now, from that peripheral nervous system comes, you know, the somatic and the automatic, which connect to that in order to make it work. Okay? So, under the sympathetic, we get what happens under the parasympathetic, what happens to all of our glands. In the sympathetic, our pupils dilate, dry, far vision. In the parasympathetic, our pupils constrict, moisten, all of that. I'll let you kind of read through so you can see that our sympathetic and our parasympathetic, though they complement each other, aren't always on the same team. Let's go. All right, now the endocrine system is the body's chemical messengers. Now they're located in different parts of our bodies in order to control and regulate different types of things. Now thyroids and parathyroids, adrenal glands, pancreas, ovaries for women, and testes for men are all part of the body's chemical messengers. Typically, we call all these messengers hormones. You've probably heard of these. We will be discussing them on a more further detail in week 3, but the endocrine system is a huge part of regulating our body and communicating information. Now the endocrine system, the big boss of the endocrine system, the person who's in charge, is named pituitary gland. Okay, it is the master gland that produces hormones influencing the secretions of all other endocrine glands. Produces hormones that influence growth attached to the hypothalamus. The pituitary gland tells everybody else what to do, how to do it, when to do it, all of that. Okay, so it is the Darth Vader of all glands. It's the guy in charge, pituitary. All right, well, this is just a nice little introduction and a nice summation of all the topics we'll be covering this week. This week is supposed to be a little bit lighter than the other weeks, just so we can get a good, strong understanding. Please make sure you're taking notes during these PowerPoints, these lectures, so you can ask questions in class. I'm here to help. Please let me know. If you have any questions, email me, talk to me in class. I'd love to hear it. Hope you have a great rest of your night, and we'll see you in class.